God bless you, loved ones. Welcome to the Word with Chester. Today we're continuing our study in the Gospel of St. Mark, chapter 4. In our last session, we read down to verse 20 in chapter 4, and today we'll begin our reading at verse 21. Let me take time to thank each of you that are contacting me and letting me know that you're listening to our broadcast. I want you to know that I appreciate you so very much. I heard from more of my California friends on today, and you made my heart glad. I want to thank God for you. Some friends that I went to school with way back in high school contacted me on today, and I want you to know that I appreciate you so very much and your kind words. They went as far as to say they are proud of me, and you don't know how that touched me. I want you to know that I love you very, very much with the love of the Lord. As we start our study today, the 21st verse of the 4th chapter of the Gospel of St. Mark, the Bible reads as this: "And he said unto them, Is a lamp brought to be put under a bushel or under a bed, and not to be set on a lampstand?" Well, let's talk about this for just a moment. Get the understanding. Now, let me recap. In our last setting, Jesus talked about the parable of the sower. Mark wrote about it from verse 13 to verse 20, where Jesus was explaining the parable of the sower. He gave the parable of the sower in an earlier part of this same chapter, in chapter 4. And in verse 13, he began to explain the parable. And Jesus talked about the sower and what the sower was. And if you want to listen to our last session, you can always go to our archives and listen to each message. We have archives where we go all the way back to the beginning of this ministry when we started teaching the Bible. For those of you that don't know what we're doing, we're teaching through the Bible, verse by verse and chapter by chapter. And we have made it this far by the grace of God. Well, in verse 21, after Jesus had gotten through explaining the parable of the sower and the seed, we found that the seed was the Word of God. If you remember in our last session, the seed is the Word. Excuse me, the ground is you and the preparation of your heart, how your heart receives it. I encourage you to listen to our last session so that I won't bore you with repeating myself too very much. For those of you that are staying with me systematically, I don't want to bore you in repeating so many things. So I encourage you that if you're not understanding what I'm saying, to go to our last session in our archives, and it'll bring you up to where we are. Verse 21, "And he said unto them, Is a lamp brought to be put under a bushel or under a bed, and not to be set on a lampstand?" That was a question he had asked them. And you use your mind when you light a lamp, you want to set it up so the entire room can be lit up. Mark used this parable and to really get an understanding. It's going to appear that a lot of things are jumbled up here in this writing, especially the first few verses that we'll be reading, 4 to 5 verses that we'll be reading, because it jumped from here and jumped to there. But you need to conjunct them with the parables and things, with these sayings, with the other gospels, and put the two gospels or three gospels together, where we get in these sayings from, to come with a good sound analogy of what we're saying. As we read verse 22, "For there is nothing hidden which shall not be manifested, neither was anything kept secret, but that it should come to light." Let me read that again for clarification. "For there is nothing hidden which shall not be manifested, neither was anything kept secret, but that it should come to light." Now, that's a saying now that get it in your spirit. I don't care what happens, it'll eventually come to the light. That's when you have to watch what you do. Sometimes you think you're doing things and maybe nobody will ever find out about it. But there's ways that things come to light. And sometimes when they come to light, some things you're not proud of. And that goes both ways. Now, you got to understand, most of the time when we use a saying like that, we we also look at the negative part of it. What's done in secret is going to come to light. Well, that's also in good things. You know, the Lord would not always have us to sound our horn when we give and do alms or help people in any type of way. He's not expecting us to get up and tell everybody what we've done for this one and, you know, every little detail of what we do to help humanity. Some things we need to do in secret. But God has a way of even turning those good things that we do in secret to make them manifest so people will know even the good things that you do. And that also goes for the negative things. God has a way, if he chooses to bring things to light and to make them manifest. No, not never to hurt you. Now, you don't have to understand that there's two spirits. There's a good spirit and there's a bad spirit. Good spirits always come from God. If something is made manifest by God, it's there to help you or help others. Well, somebody say, well, I did something many years ago and I repented of it and way years later it came to light. Well, maybe God wanted it to come to light for a reason. He might have wanted to help somebody to let them know they can get over whatever obstacles they're in their life. Some things can be used for a testimony. Well, I'm going to tell you like it is. None of us have lived perfect lives all of our lives. All of us have some down times there or have some times where we did not do the right thing. And don't fool yourself. Even those that think they've been ivy clean for all of their Christian life, you know, they're probably fooling themselves as they try to fool other people, because all of us have did some things wrong. And I'm going to go as far as to say this. Some people, the reason they didn't do something wrong is because they were scared to. Not scared of God, but scared of people. So you got to understand, if you thought it in your heart, and I can prove this by scripture, but I'm not going to take the time to do it today. If you thought it in your heart, you're just as guilty as if you'd done it. So that lets me know that all of us have done something wrong. Jesus narrowed it down, and we studied it as we studied the Gospel of St. Matthew. If you, he told a brother, now, if you look on a woman to lust after her, you've already committed adultery in your heart. So that lets us know, even if you did not go and do the act, if you were looking on someone with lust, you've already committed the act. Even though you didn't get the gratification of touching and the gratification of what all the sexual liaisons may bring, just for looking with lust, you're guilty of adultery. So Jesus said that. So even if you didn't have enough nerve to go do the act, you're still guilty even if you thought it. And sometimes people have hate in their heart and things of that nature. Jesus said if you hate your brother without a cause, you're as a murderer. So that lets me know even if you did not commit the act, if you had hate in your heart, whether that be because of a person's skin color or whether that be because of a person's religion, a person's a nationality, whatever the case may be, that lets me know if you hate them without a cause, you're just like a murderer. So all of us have sinned and all of us have come short of the glory of God. And God has a way when he's deems to bring things to light. Maybe not on an national level, but he has a way of doing it. And sometimes it's for a reason. I'm the first to admit I am not proud of everything I've done in my life, but I will tell you this: everything I've ever done wrong in my life is under the blood of Jesus. If you mess with it, that's between you and God. Well, God told you not to go fishing in the sea of forgetfulness, because he throws all of our sins when we come to him and ask him to forgive us our sins. He throws our sea into the sea of forgetfulness, and he remembers it no more. And when we go fishing in the sea of forgetfulness, trying to pull out somebody's sin, you might catch something that will shake and sink the whole ship. So things that are under the blood, we need to leave them under the blood. What are you saying, Chester? Well, we're going to talk about that as we go farther in this lesson. Well, we have to link the gospel together. And those of you that need to go to the Gospels of St. Matthew, specifically specifically around chapter 7, verse 1 and 2, where Jesus told us not to judge. Well, maybe I should read on and then we'll go into that now. That then, for there is nothing hidden which shall not be manifested, neither was anything kept secret, but that it should come to light. Verse 23, if any man have an ear, let him hear. What do you mean an ear? We have our ears, we can hear audibly, we can hear things, but I wonder if you can hear with an understanding. And this is what this writer is saying. If you have an ear, I want you to not only hear audible words, but I want you to understand what I'm saying. I want you to understand what I'm writing down. If any man have an ear, let him hear. Shall we read verse 24? And he said unto them, take heed what you hear. With what measure ye measure, it shall be measured to you. And unto you that hear shall more be given. That's a hard saying, and maybe it's hard to understand, and on the surface it is hard to understand. But I challenge you to take the likeness of what Mark is talking about. Take heed what you hear. With what measure ye measure, it shall be measured to you again. In Matthew's gospel, it says again, what measure you measure, it shall be measured to you. Well, let's link that verse up with Matthew's gospel, chapter 7. We'll read verses 1, 2, and possibly 3 in Matthew's gospel. Jesus said, judge not that ye be not judged, for with what judgment ye judge, ye shall be judged. And with what measure ye measure, it shall be measured to you again. So let's link those two sayings up. Mark said about the same thing, but maybe not use that entire verse saying word for word what Matthew said, but Jesus lets us know, with what judgment ye judge, ye shall be judged, and with what measure ye measure, it shall be measured to you again. Jesus went on in Matthew chapter 7 to talk about the mote that's in your brother's eye. You see a little mote in there, a little speck in your brother's eye, but you don't behold the beam that's in your own eye. So Matthew's gospel in chapter 7, he talked about it a little more in depth than Mark did. Verse 24, and he said unto them, take heed that ye hear. With what measure ye measure, it shall be measured to you. In so many words, what you put out, you're going to get back. Apostle Paul takes it up in his writings in the Galatians. Be not deceived. God is not mocked. For whatsoever a man soweth, that shall he also reap. So all of these scriptures, they go hand in hand. And then letting us know that whatever you put out there, you're going to get it back. You're going to reap what you sow. If you set in judgment on somebody, you're going to be judged yourself. Don't fool yourself. You can judge me all day if you want to. You can judge me until you get tired of judging. But let me let you know, you're opening up the door for your life to be judged as well. Why? You're doing something Jesus told you not to do in the first place, because Jesus, we just read it in Matthew chapter 7, judge not that you be not judged. When you set in judgment over someone else, you open the door for your own life to be judged, for your own deeds to be judged. Well, Jesus even told us we're supposed to forgive one another, even if somebody is wrong. But let me let you know something. It's not your part, it's not my part to judge. We, number one, supposed to forgive one another. We're supposed to love one another and help one another and not tear one another down. Well, Mark said it again here. Thank you, Lord. With what measure ye measure, it shall be measured to you. Whatever you get out, you're going to give it back. Whatever you sow, you're going to reap it. And I don't want to leave just on a negative note. coat and have you walking in fear, thinking that something bad going to happen to you because of this or that. I don't want you to even linger there. I'm just trying to teach you a principle. What you put out, you're going to get back. When you judge others, you open the door for yourself to be judged. But let's take it and flip it on the other side. When you do good to others, you open the door for good to happen to you. When you have a forgiving spirit to others, and don't fool yourself, there's people that have done wrong, people in the church that have done wrong, but your spirit should be the type to forgive and try to restore and try to love one till they get back up to where they need to be. When you have that type of spirit, a forgiving spirit, a loving spirit, you're opening that same door for somebody to do the same thing for you. And don't fool yourself. I know the word tells us that we're supposed to live a clean life. We are supposed to live a clean life. But let me let you know, as long as there is a devil, he's going to be tempting you. He'll tempt you to do all, to break all of the commandments. He'll teach you to lie. He'll teach you to, he'll tempt you to lie. He'll tempt you to lust. He'll tempt you to commit adultery. He'll tempt you to do everything in the book, to covet your brother's house and wife and everything else. The devil will tempt you. So don't fool yourself. Don't you think that you're above falling in temptation. But let me let you know something. If you develop a heart of love to where you're not condoning what anyone does, I would never tell you, me, or anyone else to condone sin. Because Jesus, or the Word of God, tells us that sin is wrong. Sin is an abomination. I won't go into the depths of that right now. I almost said something, but I'm going to bring that out in a different study. You got to understand, sin is a transgression of the law of God. Sin is a transgression, and the Lord does not want you or me to sin. But let me let you know, Jesus, he lets us know if any man sin. Apostle Paul lets us know as well, if any man sin, we have an advocate with the Father, and you and I are supposed to develop a loving heart, a heart that will try to restore someone and not tear them down. You watch the one that's always trying to put their foot on somebody. It's not going to be long till somebody's foot is on them. Why? Because whatever measure you measure, it's going to be measured to you. Whatever you put out, it's going to be brought back to you. Shall we read on in the Word of God here? Verse 25. And he said, and he that hath, to him shall be given. And he that hath not, from him shall be taken even what he hath. We can conjunct that passage of scripture, that verse, again with Matthew's gospel, when Jesus gave the parable of the talents, where he gave one five, another one two, and another one one. The one that had five went and gained other five and brought them back to his Lord. And his Lord said, well done, that good and faithful servant. You've been faithful over a few things. I'm going to make you rule over many. Said the same thing that had two talents and went and gained other two and brought back to his master, his Lord. But then there was one. He only had one talent now. He went and buried it in the earth. And when his Lord came to reckon with him, he had this long sob story. Lord, I knew that you were one who gathered where you didn't sow this, that, and the other. And here's what you gave me. I don't have no more to get put with it, but here's what you gave me. Here's what is yours. That servant took from him and gave it to the one who he had given the 10 talents. You got to understand that everyone that has, it's going to be, you're going to receive much more than what you do. Let me read that again. For he that hath, to him shall be given, and he that hath not, from him shall be taken even which he had. So we have to conjunct that scripture. scripture to get a fullness of what we're trying to understand here. You can't just let it stand on its own. It has to be some logic to it, because we're talking about the overall teaching of Jesus, the overall picture of what Jesus was trying to portray to us. Verse 25, for he that hath, to him shall be given, and he that hath not, from him shall be taken, even that which he has. Well, I'm trying to watch my clock here, because I don't want to go too long today. While I'm on the subject, I want to thank those in YouTube. I don't know who is responsible for it, but I had a 15-minute slot that I had to fit everything in. But I don't know why, and I don't know how, but I am grateful for it. They extended my time, but I don't want to infringe upon you, the listener, and hold you too very long in each setting. But I do want you to know the Word of God is very rich. Let's read on in verse 26. And he said, so is the kingdom of God, as if a man should cast seed into the ground, and should sleep, and rise night and day, and the seed should spring and grow up, he knoweth not how. For the earth bringeth forth fruit of itself, first the blade, then the ear, after that the full grain in the ear. Verse 29, but when the fruit is brought forth, immediately he putteth in the sickle, because the harvest is come. This is what the kingdom of God is like, and this is what Mark is trying to get over to you. When a man sows the seed, remember we got through reading in our last session about the parable of the sower. When we sow the seed, when we put out the Word of God, we're not there looking every second for the grass to come up, for the blade of the plant to break through the soil, but we just put it out there, and after a time, God begins to work the miracle. Same way when you plant in the ground, you put the seed out there, and then as time goes on, first you see that blade come up. Are you with me? Verse 27, when you go to sleep and rise night and day, and the seed should spring and grow up, he knoweth not how. You don't know all of the logic of how everything germinates, and we got some horticulturalists and all of these things that can explain things and all of that good stuff, but you and I, the average person, we don't have all the specifics of what happened, but we do know when we plant a seed, it'll come up, for the earth bringeth forth fruit of itself, first the blade, then the ear, after that the full grain is in the ear, but when the fruit is brought forth, immediately he put it in the sickle, because the harvest is come. We plant seed, glory to God, God just gives us what to say, and we put out the word. We don't know who is falling on. We don't know the good ground, the bad ground, the stony ground. But all we do is plant the seed. God gives the increase. As we sleep, as we toil, as we pray, as we do our devotion, God begins to make that seed germinate, to let it grow up, and then go into its full fruit. When the full fruit is there, then he takes the sickle and harvests it. I want you to know the harvest truly is plenteous, but the laborers are few. Well, God wants us to, yes, he wants us to do something in his vineyard. He wants us to do a work for him. Plant the seed wherever you can, whether that's on the job, whether that's in your home, in your community. He'll give the increase. Don't worry about who's growing up because of the seed you planted. I'm not worried. All I am worried about is planting the seed. Please excuse me. If I plant the seed, God will give the increase. Well, my friends, my time is rapidly running out for this session, but I want you to know I love you with the love of the Lord. If you have questions for me, if you would like to talk to me for any reason, if you would like to donate to this ministry, you can write me 3741 Candle Bluff Drive, San Antonio, Texas, 78244. You can contact me at my website, www.poemsbychester.com. Remember, I love you, my friends, with the love of the Lord. God bless you.